Well, here we go again. It's the Sal and Rich Show. Warning ESPN and Philadelphia Sports Talk 94 WIP. We have some heavy-duty former athletes from 1973 and 1974 in the studio today. We talk to the administrators and creators of the Paul 6 High School New Jersey Alumni Athletes Facebook page. Today, our guests from 1973 are Al McDonald and Larry Rocco. From 1974, we have Donna Camardo. But today, we hope to get an answer to a burning question. After working for PVI for 20 years and attending for 4 years, why haven't they changed the name of the school to the Donna Camardo High School? Let's get it answered. Let's get the show started.
Let's find out. Why
That's
not, Donna?
A great question.
Oh, wait a minute. Hold on a second.
It's not McDonald. Who is it?
We do have somebody here. All the way from the Meadowlands.
Who?
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, Taylor Swift.
Taylor Swift.
Bring her in, Taylor.
Has anybody seen Transformers?
Oh, my God. Look at this.
You know anything.
Tops the Speedo. Oh, my gosh. That's great. Oh, man.
The best part is he had hair on his head when he took it off.
Well, we got double use out of the wig, so we're
happy. I love it. Yeah, you got your money's back.
Oh, my God.
Let's see here. Hold on. All right, we're set. Thank you all. This has been a technology feat. We spent probably an hour trying to get the four box set up here, and we finally have done it. Yeah, that took technical training. We had to fly somebody down to Bluffton. We spared no expense. So anyway, so the
may
purpose
have been quicker.
If we would have flown somebody down, that's right. Thank you all for coming. The intent of today's show is to highlight what you guys have done, not only at Paul 6 as far as athletes, but also Donna's contribution there working. And Donna, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you were a coach there also.
Yes, I was a coach there from 2002 to 2013.
Okay, cool. And basketball, right?
Right.
Okay, cool. So I guess we'll start. We'll go around robin. Let's start with Mr. Rocco down in Bluffton. Larry, why don't you tell our listeners, viewers.
Don't away.
Yeah, and then we'll get back up to New Jersey. give people an idea of how and the whole page, PVI Athletic Facebook page, came about, and what you guys have been up to with regard to that.
Well, the page came about. I got invited to a alumni athletes meeting, a small group that Fran Maschuli started with a couple other guys, and they had some coaches showing up, and I kept getting invited to it. Tom McCarville, Jed, he invited me, and I could never make it. I mean, I'm 750 miles away, and every time I was up in Jersey, it wasn't going on.
Right.
The one time I was going to be in Jersey, I was really excited, and I talked to Fran about it, and I said, would it be cool if I made a Facebook page just for alumni athletes? He said, that'd be great. Well, we had the meeting, and it ended up we had like 40-some people show up from his normal 10, 15. And now I believe I was just on there. Somebody just posted something, and I just answered them. I think we're up. Al, what are we up to, about 460, 470?
Yeah, about 460 now.
Okay.
Wow.
460 people. And that's right now it's just open to the athletes. We've been bannering the administrators. Al's one of the administrators, Deirdre Kane. We've been bannering around about opening it up to everybody. We're still not sure yet because there's just a lot of memories there. The purpose of the Facebook page was to let the present athletes from our years, the founding of the school, know how everything got started and what the athletes back then were faced with. For example, somebody posted about the field behind the school.
Yeah.
And Donna's laughing. She remembers that field, right? You know, it wasn't rocks. It was boulders. I mean, it was crazy. And the track, we were at the township using the track. So that's how it all came about. And it's working out pretty good. A little slow getting people to contribute. And I'm going to throw a shameless plug in here. Please, please, Donna, Al, anybody, Al posted a picture, one of the coolest pictures ever to hit the Courier Post concerning Paul Six athletes, Al playing baseball. No. And so the pictures, the articles, please post them.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, I obviously wasn't an athlete, but watching and reading the posts that you have from the Courier Post and other newspapers, it's really cool. And it brings back a lot of memories. I forgot how good we were in our early years in track. I mean, that post the other day that Mike Chapman put up about Shepard, I totally, you know, I mean, I remember it once I read it, but the guy was unbelievable. I think he was a state championship, correct? If I have that right.
Yeah.
He's amazing.
Yeah. And in 1972, we went 10-0 in the track team.
Wow.
I mean, things like that. It was back then with the resources that we had. Best resources were our coaches. We had right. phenomenal coaches.
And you think about it, the school was what, at that point, what, 5 years old at best? So, yeah, that's quite an accomplishment. Who was the, yeah. you mentioned the coaches, who were the coaches that you guys were dealing with or working with?
Started out with Vince Sidario and Dub Weir. And right. then we had Bottinger in the weights. Bob Duffy came along, and that's the guy that really humbled me personally, because he saw that I was a slacker, that I had potential, and he kept me after one day, and he ran me into the ground. Everybody else was gone. Ran me into the ground, and then he looked at me afterwards, and I'm literally laying on the ground. He says, "See, you can do this. You have the potential. You just got to work for everything." And yeah. that stuck with me the rest of my life.
Yeah, that's great. That's awesome. It's little things like that that stick with you. Did you?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Rich, I don't think your mic is on. Did you hear me?
You're right, because if we had turned it on, it would have flawlessly had executed this whole thing.
Oh, okay.
Was Rich Myers a coach originally?
I think when we were there, Larry would know better. I don't think he was.
He was a physical science teacher, I think he was called. He went to Camden Catholic.
Yes.
Red hair guy.
Yeah, I remember him.
Everybody does.
And so.
Talking about John Myers?
No, it was Rich Myers.
John Myers was a coach, and he does live down the shore.
Did he have real long hair?
Yeah.
Yeah,
and Rich, good looking guy.
I have the wrong Myers.
Yeah, Rich Myers graduated from Camden Catholic in 63 with my older brother. So
Okay.
Well,
Sal.
Yeah.
Sal, you were famous for a couple other things though. You know that, right?
No.
I mean, you never autographed it for me. I still have the album that your picture's on and my picture's in there and a couple other guys from Paul Six when we were in grade school.
You're kidding. I totally forgot about that. I'd be happy to sign that for you.
Then. Okay, but I'll bring it with
you. Worth a lot of money now.
Yeah, that and $5 to get you a cup of coffee at Starbucks. Wow, I totally forgot that. You got to send me a picture of that. Yeah. Well, Clay was in the choir too. I played sousaphone in grade school. Yeah, with Tommy Quayle.
That's right.
Yeah, that was me. I was so big.
Yeah.
Anyway, let's switch over to Al and Donna. Al, give us a little bit of a synopsis of your athletic prowess at Paul Six and what you've been up to since you graduated.
I wouldn't use the word prowess, but I played football 1 year of basketball, and then I played baseball. And to go along with what Larry said, we had great coaches. Mm-hmm. I mean, my baseball, I had Danny O'Brien and Jimmy O'Brien and Coach Pontiac. And you couldn't meet better people. And then with football, with Bottinger, I'm lucky enough. I still correspond with Coach Bottinger a few times a year. You know, he emails me, I email him. And
nice.
He was a great – I learned a lot of lessons from him. You know, with the whole impossible dream thing, I still have the little horse that they – the Man of La Mancha they gave us that plays the song. And I had it actually played at my wedding.
Did you?
And it's probably why I'm single now, but I probably shouldn't say that. No, then I coached football for 2 years at Paul Six when I was in college. I helped coach the freshman team, and got to meet a lot of the kids. And the one guy who's a really good contributor on the our page is Dom Chavone, and I coached him in football. And there was something about him and I became very close back then, because I think he didn't believe in himself, and then he became a terror. He's a teacher now, and the old Woodrow Wilson. He's just a really good guy. And I coached Billy Deary's brother, Tommy Deary, and he was probably one of the best athletes I've ever seen. He had it all. And then after that, I just, I had five kids. I coached a lot of youth sports in town, basketball, soccer, baseball, you name it. And I'm here today.
Yeah. What position did Tommy?
My buddy and I, we ran the Barrington basketball program for about 8 years. Then I was the president of the Little League. And then I coached soccer, which was great because I knew nothing about soccer. But we had fun doing it, so anything to help the kids. And now I have 11 grandkids. And I don't coach anytime, but I drive them around and go to a lot of games.
Man, that's crazy.
11 grandchildren. Wow.
You mentioned Tommy Deary. What position did he play? Did he play quarterback too?
Well, his best position was safety. And that's what he played in college at Widener. I'm pretty sure he was an All-American at Widener when he went there. And, I used to tell him, I said, I thought your brother, the two best athletes I ever saw at Paul Six, not including the track guys, were Bob Jackson and Billy Deary. I mean, they were extra special. And then when I saw his brother Tommy, I said, you're just as good as your brother. I said, you are. And he didn't believe in himself. But man, he was a heck of an athlete.
So that's Bill went to William & Mary.
He passed away.
He passed away?
Bill passed away. I think he had a brain tumor. I'm not 100% sure.
Man. Oh, wow.
I know he passed away.
Oh, that's a shame.
Bob Jackson, I think, lives down in Virginia Beach, that area.
Okay.
Cool. Yeah. I didn't realize that about Bill Deary.
That's
unfortunate. Yeah. So, Donna. You've got the longest tenure. You graduated in 1974 and you hung around, did some coaching. Kind of tell us a little bit about your career. Talk about your coaching first.
Okay. So I taught for 34 years total. My first half of my career was at Cherokee High School, where there were a lot of former Paul Six people that worked there. And then I came to Paul Six in 2001. Carol Stutz Harris was the coach at that time. I took over for her, and I took a program that was probably 2-22. And by about the fifth or sixth year, we were in the playoffs. We had winning records. We had some good athletes. And I coached up through my daughter's tenure, which I don't know that I'd recommend coaching your own child at the high school level. But anyway, it was fun, but it had its ups and downs. And probably from the point of maybe 2010 on, we were really, really competitive. And then I stopped coaching in 2013. And now the head coach now, Orlando Hidalgo, has brought them to the state games for the last 2 years. Wow. And probably he's pretty loaded for the next couple of years as well. So while I was there, we kind of lived off, as we said, having great coaches. I had Vicky Harrington Orzechowski.
Right.
And there's no better woman to have as a mentor, in my opinion, than she. And I had as role models people like Deirdre Kane, Mary Scharf. You can't go wrong.
Right.
Mary and I were very close. We stayed close up until, her death. She was one of the first players that helped me coach for the first few years. And I was more of a cheerleader. I wasn't an X and O's, but I could get the kids to believe in themselves. And that was kind of my role. But Mary would take over the X's and O's, until she really couldn't anymore.
Yeah.
And that was great. That was just a great experience.
That's super.
I think Vicky taught
She did.
At Paul Sixwell, Sal and I were there.
She taught 1 year while I was there, Vicky's, and then she went to Cherokee.
Gofani,
yeah.
And she went to high school of Rich Myers.
Right. And she actually, she was at Cherokee before me. And when I got out of college, after like my third year out of teaching elementary school, I went to Cherokee to teach high school, and she and I coached together at Cherokee. So it's a very small circle sometimes, but you know, it's a small world for sure.
Yeah.
But I taught there as well. I taught math. I was an assistant to the athletic director for the last, I don't know, 5 or 6 years before I retired. And then it was a toss up. Do I take the athletic director job fully or not? And at that point, the 12-hour days were just getting to be a lot. It was 2 years of COVID, that trying to teach during COVID and have athletics during COVID, it just was tiring.
Yeah,
and I just felt as though a younger person needed to step in. Although, you know, I don't know that I was ready to retire, because I have to say this honestly, I was very fortunate to get up every day and want to go to work. I loved working at Paul Six. I loved the people. I mostly loved the kids and the athletics. I still follow a lot of the kids. I was at Drexel yesterday to see one of our soccer players who plays for Drexel. So I try to follow a lot of the kids that I was close with a few years back.
That's great.
So
I've said this before. Last year when we were putting our reunion together, I went in to see Gabriel McCluskey.
Yes.
He was going to supply us with books. Here I am sitting in the lobby in the middle of July, and all these kids are walking into school happy as could be. And I thought, what after world am I in right now? This just didn't seem normal. And they were all friendly. Hello, how are you? And I asked Gabrielle about it. I said, what's wrong with these kids? She said, they love it here.
Yeah, it's a really good school.
Great.
And the kids are very, very good. Yeah. This year's freshman class is the biggest that they've had in a while. It's nowhere near, you know, what it was when we were there, but you know, parents won't tolerate the class sizes either that they did when we were there. But it's really, Sister Mary Ann, you have to give her credit where credit is due. She kept us open during COVID. She built up that school. She built up the faculty. She had an eye for sports. She hired good people. The legacy of Paul Six is really, in my opinion, on her shoulders. I mean, she did a great job. And then she retired. She's going to be 80 this year. So she retired.
She's going to be 80.
Yeah. And up until 78, I used to say, like, if I am like 1/10 as good at 78 as she was, I mean, talk about tech savvy. She had the latest of everything. So consequently, so did Paul Six. Like,
so
we
she
were
wasn't,
first. With
she
the
wasn't
iPad,
like Larry Rocco.
First with the computer.
Right?
No.
Glad I was here all too. We couldn't figure
no,
this
not
out.
Like me either. She used to laugh at me. I'd be like, I don't know how to do this. What are you kidding? So
that's funny.
Somebody told me that before COVID came out, before, I guess it was like March of 2020.
Right.
She was prepared for it like 3-4 months before that, because she was reading articles about some disease spreading through the world. And Paul Six was prepared.
Yeah, we were very prepared to the, I mean, like I said, we were able to stay open.
Wow.
And the hard part, in my opinion, for teachers was that it was just tough. Like, you had kids at home and you had kids at school. And, you know, you're trying to, the technology was not always on task, you know, so you had to kind of fly by the seat of your pants at sometimes.
So you had people like Larry
trying to sign in, or you had Larry who just like put like a you know, or you had kids that, you know, put a picture of themselves there and weren't really there, you know, that kind of stuff. But
that's something I would have done.
It was just tiring. It was just, the great thing about COVID was athletics, though. I gotta say, staying open and having games with no parents in the stands yelling at you, The coaches loved it.
So, I bet.
But I it was bet. Funny because it was just so weird. So we actually had a fundraiser where we did those placards. You could have a picture of like your dad, your mom, your brother, your dog, whatever. And I would go around and put them in the bleachers so that you couldn't have fans, but you had all these faces in all the bleachers. And it was actually, it became like a lot of fun. It was fun.
That's great.
And I have to credit that to Lisa Steele, who was a basketball coach at that time. That was her idea.
And Janice and I know a lot of people in this area that are pulling their kids out of the public high school.
Sure.
And they're sending them over to Paul Six.
A lot of people are going either private, charter, or Christian schools. I mean, it's a sacrifice for the parents, of course. Paul Six does a good job as best they can with financial aid, but it's still, it's tough.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah. Gabrielle told us when
your priority is there and
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt. We got a little bit of a lag here. When we were visiting with Gabrielle, she mentioned that there's been a huge influx of new students because of what's going on with education in the country. And, so I asked her, I said, well, what's the current cost to go here? And it was $12,500 a year. And I just kind of chuckled to myself because when I went there, it was like less than $300 a year. But that's inflation. Right. That's the way it goes.
Yeah.
But
$12,500 is all in.
So. Right. But the other thing I will say, and Rich and I talk about this all the time, is, and I've said it on previous podcasts, the school is in incredible shape. I mean, I didn't know what I was expecting, but I didn't expect it to look exactly like I had left it 50 years ago. It's Larry. Have you been up there recently to see it?
No. And you know what? It's a shame. I would love to be able to check it out. And especially that new track they have. I'm so jealous of that. Oh my gosh.
It's impressive.
But yeah.
Well, the next time you're up in town, you go
to school. And again,
I'm sorry, Gabrielle. I mean, she'll give you a tour. She gave us a tour. So it's worth it.
Well, I got to say, I did go there one time, and I'm going back years ago. I was a detective at the time, and we were doing a new hire, and he was a high school graduate from Paul Sixth. And I went in, and I'm trying to remember the name of the nun that was the principal back then. I'm guessing this was in the late 80s, early 90s. And I gave the receptionist my card. I said, background check on a student, former student. And the nun's walking down the hallway looking at my car, and she looks up at me, and she's looking at me, and she says, oh, no way. She couldn't believe I became a cop. I wasn't bad in school, really, but my grades were terrible. I think I'm the only one in the history to ever fail the entire sophomore year. But yeah, she was astounded.
Yeah, she's like, oh, no, he's back.
Yeah. Oh.
That's funny. That's great.
You talk about going back to Paul Six. A few of you know, my son was a college basketball coach and I used to recruit for him. And I hadn't been in Paul Six in 30 years. And I went in there to recruit a player and I walked in. I spent most of my time walking around the school instead of watching the kid play. And the school's beautiful. I think it's actually in better shape than when we were there.
Absolutely.
I mean, the gym's gorgeous. Well, they actually have a football field now instead of a rock garden. But, you know, I remember when I was a freshman going out for baseball, I showed up with spikes on at practice. And we had 175 kids. We practiced in the parking lot.
Wow.
That's where our first practices were. Then we practiced for like 2 hours and Danny O'Brien took us in the back on the rocks. And we didn't have a backstop when we were having a batting practice and everything. But the school's come a long way.
And look how tough you were because you practiced on rocks.
My knees are still killing me from that, you know. But I said, I told you this once before, Donna. We had three kids on my son's team from Paul Six. And I actually sent a picture in to Marianne Rauscher, who put it in SOAR magazine. And quality of the person and the athlete that came from Paul Six was very high up there as far as the kids on my son's team. We had Vashawn Mack, Ivan Robinson, Devontae Mosley, and these were three tremendous human beings.
Ivan is still there coaching.
I heard that. Ivan's a great guy. I communicate with him every once in a while on Twitter. We go back and forth. He just got promoted at work.
Yes.
Yeah.
Can somebody please explain what Twitter is to Larry?
Yeah. Oh, come on, Larry. They're giving you a hard time.
We're going to explain what Twitter is.
I missed that. I was daydreaming.
It's called X now.
We have to explain to you what Twitter is.
That's the verb that you don't like when I'm in my
That's right. It's now called X, so it's even more confusing. Thanks to Elon Musk.
Man, that was my badge number, so see, I can remember that.
There you go.
Gosh.
Donna, why don't you talk about your 501c you mentioned, and I think, I won't remember the young lady's name, but someone who got a scholarship to Notre Dame. Basketball player.
Oh, Hannah Hidalgo.
That's it.
Yeah. Hannah Hidalgo is one of those players that's once in a lifetime. Anybody who saw her play, I mean, you're just amazed at how good she is. It was so good for our school and for the kids because we had so many college coaches come into girls' games that it was crazy. And even just fans, like little kids would want her autograph. You know, they would go up and want to talk to her after the games. I was very involved with her recruiting process, and her mom is actually on my committee of the 501C. And she's just a great athlete. She will have a really good career at Notre Dame. She's the only other high school All-American to graduate from Paul Six other than Karen Robinson. Mm. And so I made a connection with Karen Robinson and Hannah. So Karen came the night she signed with Notre Dame, and Karen has significantly contributed to the 501C in the name of Hannah and Martina Atanasi and herself. And she was nice enough to throw my name in as well.
That's nice.
Not that my athleticism is anywhere near any of theirs, but it's an organization that I felt we had a need for because a lot of our competitors were losing athletes to them because they were offering more financially, right. Which you really can't do unless you have an alumni base or a base that can pay the bills.
Right.
So what we started was Friends of PVI for qualifying students. It's geared mainly towards incoming freshmen to close the gap between what Paul Six offers in financial aid and what the parent can afford. And a lot of times, well, we just got started this year and it's has to be based on grades, financial need, and the fact that they will participate in something extracurricular, whether it's band, the play, or football. Like, they have to participate in something.
Right.
And so this year we were able to help 5 kids, which was really nice. And what we did was we were able to pay for their iPad, their registration, and their uniforms, which comes to about $1,000.
Wow.
So if we could help 5 kids a year, you know, I'm not looking to make a fortune. But if we can do something like that, we had a huge fundraiser rummage sale, which was way more work than I ever anticipated. But again, it raised money and it all just goes back for the kids. And plus I'm trying to target some of the alumni that are younger that don't really feel like they should give to anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And if I reach out to them and say, like, $500 buys their iPad, and they're like, oh, okay, I didn't think that would help at all. You know, well, every single dime helps.
Right.
So that's kind of my mindset, is, you know, we have a dine and donate coming up at the Oakland Manor, which was bought out by 2 Paul Six graduates.
Nice.
So we're trying to help them, you know, grow their business, and they're trying to help us, you know, raise some money.
That's great.
But
really, really good.
It is strictly a scholarship, you know, based on academics and need.
Yeah. Okay. That's quite an accomplishment. And
the dine and donate is going to be October 25th. Yeah. October 25th, 6 to 9 at the Oakland Manor, if you're in the area.
You know what? You should also post that up on the Facebook page, you know, the Paul Six Alumni Facebook page. Advertise.
Larry, didn't you do that for me already?
I
I thought Larry, didn't you do that already?
I did it once, but you know what? Could you do me a
favor? Yeah, well, we'll keep doing it.
Keep doing it every now and then. Just put it up there.
Oh, awesome. That'd be great.
Yeah. Larry posted about the fun you're having. I don't think he did it at the Dine and Donate.
Oh, all right. Yeah. Well, I'll get you the flyer, Larry.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Well, or you can do it yourself. You know.
That's true. I think.
Yeah, that's true.
I will.
Seriously.
Sounds like a plan.
And
anything to get people together. I think it, and plus, I think it'd be fun.
Right. And on that note, any current athletes, former athletes that, you know, that are new, that are a little afraid to join up with us, a lot of memories there. They can get the history of their entire sport just from going on that page.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is good. I don't know what happened to all my newspaper articles. I have a lot about Mary Scharf. I'm going to have to dig through those. But we also started at Paul Six when I was there, a wall along the gym honoring some athletes who significantly contributed. It started with Bill Curry. Is that right?
Tim Curry.
Tim Curry. And then we added Mary Scharf. We have Andrew Bailey up there. We have Martina Atanasi. Hopefully we'll have Karen Robinson.
Is Jean Coya?
No, but if you have, you know, ideas of people that significantly contributed, like, and then ultimately when Hannah leaves Notre Dame, she'll be up there. She's the first and only 2,000 point scorer that Paul Six has ever had.
Wow.
And that was with a COVID year. So
I don't think John Conway had that many points.
No, he did not. No one has.
That's great.
So hopefully fantastic. She'll remember us, which I think she will.
Oh, I
so
think she will.
When she gets her NIL deal.
Yeah. She probably you know. Got it.
Yeah. No, she doesn't have anything yet because I'm involved with that. But it's coming, I'm sure.
So what is the difference between the organization you're funding right now versus Giving November? Is that what it is?
Yeah. Giving November goes directly to the school, which is why I try not to target people who already give, because that goes towards the president's annual giving campaign. And he has to make a certain amount of money budget-wise in that so that the school can function. Mine's extra. So mine is above and beyond, and it comes to our organization. You get the same tax write-off, you know, that you get with Mr. Chambers' President's Fund, but it's mainly for people who maybe haven't ever given. I mean, that's who I try to reach out to, or are hesitant because they don't know where their money's going. Whereas with me, you know, it's going to tuition. It's not going to any capital campaigns. It's not going to anything else. It's going right to the kids. So that's the difference.
And Gabriel McCluskey will be on.
Right.
November,
she's great.
Yeah. November 2nd.
Yeah, she's doing a nice job. I mean, she had a lot to learn after Marianne Yeager.
November 2nd.
Yep.
I
we
think
haven't booked. It's our booking agent.
Some of us are going to Italy, and we're not around.
I knew that was coming.
Hey,
some
I'm
of
Italian.
Us going to Italy. We can't do the show from Italy.
Yeah,
yeah. No, we're doing the show from Italy. Hard. I mean, I think she could use. You know, like I try to do whatever I can to get the word out for her with different things. One thing I have to say about Paul Six is they really don't nickel and dime you once you're in. They have three fundraisers and that's it that the kids, you know, they ask to participate in. And they're, you know, the ad and patron drive that was there when I was there.
Yeah.
You know, the fashion show, which was also a thing for quite a few years, but it wasn't when we were there.
I don't remember
there.
That. We
and
didn't have a
the
fashion show.
So they have those. Yeah.
We didn't have one of
they
those.
They have those three big fundraisers and that's it. You know, they're not asking you for stuff, you know, and that's why sister didn't like, you know, anybody doing their own ad books or their own, you know, programs where they were asking for people for ads. So when I started this 501c, I did meet with Mr. Chambers and assure him that I wasn't trying to take anyone away from his annual giving, but ultimately whoever gives to me, it's all going to the same pot. It's going right to tuition.
So you may be retired.
Correct.
but you are still, the only thing you're not doing is teaching.
Correct. And getting paid.
They should maybe make a position called alumni head.
Yeah, yeah, right. Seriously. Well, I don't know. If you talk to Dennis Scuderi, our new football coach, he would love to have me do his football operations. But I don't know that that'll ever happen.
Well, you know what? I sort of always thought that like Camden Catholic had such a legacy of alumni.
Mm-hmm.
And people contributed.
Right. And that's exactly.
And PBI was missing out on it.
They were.
And they didn't catch students from the early days, the 60s and the 70s, and maybe even the 80s.
Right.
But it seems like they're really working hard on it.
They are. And so I'm going after the 90s and the 2000s. Like my kids were in there. I had a son graduate in 2008 and a daughter graduate in 2013.
Okay.
So I'm going after like the 80s, 90s, and thousands.
People who are not on Social Security.
Exactly. Exactly. I mean, I'll take, please don't get me wrong, I'll take anybody's money. But yeah, I'll take your check right now. But for the most part, I'm trying. And because then if you get them that way on a personal level and you get them invested, even with $50, like that's what I try to tell them, $10, I'll take, you know,
right.
Then they start to want to follow it. You know, like when I was telling people about Hannah Hidalgo and I had somebody donate, then I sent them the girls' basketball schedule and they actually came to one of the games, but they have to feel wanted. They have to feel like they're a part of something.
Yeah, not just giving money.
Exactly. Yeah. So I think that's tough for one person to do, you know, so, but that's where that 501c was born.
That's great. I'm glad you're doing that. It sounds terrific. While we're talking about...
And your class has a reunion this weekend, right?
We have a Friday night, we're at Kathy Daniels' house, and then Saturday, we're at the Merchantville Country Club.
Okay.
And Larry's actually coming.
Really?
Yes.
Is Larry going to count on GPS to bring him here?
No, he's flying.
He's going to want a pilot to bring him here.
I'm going to count on United... whatever the number is.
How many people attending?
I really don't know. Well, I'm going to find out tomorrow night because I have a dinner to go to tomorrow night, and the Kathy who's running it is going to be there.
Okay.
So she'll give us. We've been trying to contact. I've been searching for people, sending it out. And the one thing about it, as you get older with reunions, a lot of people say, I didn't talk to people for 30 years. Why would I come? So I posted a thing on our website. I said, This might be the last one you come to.
Yeah.
You don't know. We're getting that age where, you know,
yeah,
you might have 20 years, you might have 20 minutes. You don't know. So I told people to make an effort.
With Kathy Daniels involved, I'm surprised. I'm sure there'll be a good turnout.
But good point, because since we had our reunion, we've lost two people in our class.
We just had a girl.
Kathy Barbara Knoll.
Oh, yeah.
And Rose Holden.
Yeah.
And
we just had a girl die. We just had a girl pass away last week. We're about 35 passed away in our class so far.
We have about 50.
Yeah.
We'll beat you.
Yeah. Oh. Overall, that's not something to beat us at.
I know. We have about,
and on that happy
we
note,
have about 152 at the reunion. And we found everybody before you came.
I've been lucky enough. I've gone to every reunion, and it's usually the same people all the time. You get a few, but in the last few reunions, a group of us have gotten together, and we still get together like once every quarter just to see each other.
That's great.
You know, it is nice. It was, you have nothing but memories. And high school is not great for everybody, and there's a lot of bad moments and things you don't like. But who cares? It's over with. We're all older now.
Yeah, more than I care to remember.
Hopefully, wiser.
It don't get any worse than failing an entire year and having the coaches beg Father Pack to let the guy back in.
You just wanted to join our class.
You were just looking for attention, Larry.
That was a bad funny. Year.
Talking about stories.
Yeah.
Oh,
somebody posted a picture of Green Valley on our class website.
Gosh, yeah.
All everybody talked about was walking to Green Valley from Paul Six through the woods and the many things that happened on the way.
Yes.
That's probably why we got Fields.
Oh, man, that's
funny.
There were
some good times, and it was woods behind Hole 6.
That's great. Hey, well, like about everybody, I want to...
One of our guys, Joe Fultano.
I'm sorry, Al. I just want to... Because we're coming up against our... We usually try to keep this about 45 minutes, but one thing I do want to say before we leave is I want to thank you guys for getting behind the Mike Bush nomination. That was really, really special, not only to Mike, but to all of us. I don't know how he got overlooked. Now, we don't know yet. Rich, you got any updates? I don't think there are any updates.
When does that happen?
I don't think it happens until after the new year is when we'll know who's in and who's not.
Well, we had a full court press, and I know from Gabrielle, I don't know what the number is, but she said there was a lot of people that voted for Mike. So thanks to all of you guys for getting behind that, because it was really important to us. Excuse me, I got the ragweed throat this morning.
We're fortunate enough to watch. I was told those.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
What did Larry say?
He said,
for those of us who were fortunate enough to watch, and guys that like Al that played with him, the guy was unbelievable.
I couldn't believe I didn't even think about him not being in.
Right.
Because not only was he a great football player, track, he was unbelievable. Track.
Yeah.
You know, and the first play I saw when Jack Bottinger put the wishbone in, we were playing Gloucester Catholic, and the first play, they pitched it to Mike Bush, and he went like 80 yards for a touchdown. First time we ran the triple option.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, he's quite an athlete.
I'll tell you a quick story about Mike Bush.
Yeah.
Mike Bush in track, he ran the 100, and they put me in there as a freshman with him against Camden. Well, by some miracle, I came in third. Well, Mike Bush, school hero, turns around to me at the end of the race, jogs over to me, shakes my hand, says, good job.
Wow.
Now, I'm like a freshman going, did Mike Bush just shake my hand? This is unbelievable. And I told him that, too, at the last time I got to see him.
Class act.
Good man.
Yeah, real, real good man. And he's going through some medical issues, but hopefully he's in speedy recovery. And we're keeping our fingers crossed that he gets the nod on the Hall of Fame. anybody else got anything else they want to wrap up? Do we forget something? I think what you guys are doing is incredible. It is really, you've kind of brought a sense of community back. And that's what we're trying to do with this little podcast of ours. But to have that Facebook page is really, really cool. And I know I appreciate it. And there's a lot of good feedback. Did you have something?
One thing, and Larry already brought this up. If the people that are watching this podcast, if you haven't signed up for the Facebook page, get on there. And if you have some memorabilia at home, post it on there. People are posting cards, little letter, anything you have, put on there, because it really does bring back a lot of memories. You know, and I remember going to Paul Six, and I'm a kid from Lindenwald. We were always considered the Sticks. And I walked in there and said, oh my God, there is tremendous athletes in this school. I mean, I thought I was a good athlete. I was a minor leaguer compared to most of these people.
Yeah.
I mean, there's just such a rich tradition there. And I want people to get a part of this. We have 460 on there. We should get up in the 800s easily.
Yeah.
Maybe we could do like a video of the gym or something, or the facilities, and put it up on the Facebook page, because what you're saying, the history, when I was there in athletics, we redid all the banners in the gym because there was one of our principals that really didn't care very much for athletics, and they all kind of disappeared. And so we had to redo all the history. So we redid all the banners in the gym, and it's amazing how many titles we have, whether it be state, sectional, or conference. And I think people, I mean, I know they put it in the publications, the number, but until you walk into the gym and actually see it, it's amazing how much, you know, that we've accomplished. I know track has multiple banners just because we ran out of room. you know, so it would be really cool to just, you know, do something like that, you know, for people to see.
That's a great idea. Yeah.
That's a good idea.
I'm in, just send it to me. Well, you could, honestly, Bonnie, you could post it yourself too. Not a problem. Al's one of the administrators, myself, Deirdre. We'll green light it in a heartbeat.
I'll meet up with Al. We'll go up and do it.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Sounds good.
One other thing. Go ahead, Rich.
Any recommendations who you would like to see on this podcast?
Yeah.
Deirdre Kane.
Yeah, Deirdre's tough to get.
She's Atlantic. Kate May.
Johnny Grimes, I don't know if you could get him, but he's another one who played at William and Mary and then played for the Houston Texans. No, I was going to say Deirdre would be great. She does. Yeah, she does a nice job.
I'll say one thing about Deirdre too. They're going to name the court at Westchester University after her.
They did.
They just announced.
Oh wow, yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah,
that's pretty impressive.
That's real impressive. That's what I was going to mention because I saw Joe Izzy posted that guest this morning. So that's quite an accomplishment. That's really cool. So we'll keep working to try.
One other thing about Mary Scharf, when my son became a basketball coach and we played Immaculata. When you go up to that college, it's like a shrine.
Yeah.
Her name's on the wall. Then they have the ball when they won the national championship. It's very impressive.
Wow.
Well, she's in the Naismith Hall of Fame. Yeah. It's crazy.
Yes. Yes.
Did you see the movie The Mighty Max?
Yes.
That's a great movie. See it if you didn't see it.
Okay, I will.
I remember when I was a sophomore at Ball Six, I came home to my dad one day and I said, there's a girl at the school who plays like a boy. And she had a better jump shot than most of the guys. And she was just tremendous at basketball.
Yeah.
I didn't think I'd ever see a player as good as her until I watched Hannah.
Yeah. Tell you a quick true story about Deirdre. We were friends since fifth grade. And basketball, she would make me look like she would be bouncing. I posted that picture, that the comedic thing where the little girl is tuning this boy up on the court and bounces it off his head and then makes the basket. But she literally took me to the hoop and just put me on the ground.
Yeah, she's
amazing.
She's something else. Another OLG graduate, right?
That's
great.
So we are into this 42 minutes now.
Yeah, I know.
We're gonna wrap it or what?
We're gonna wrap this up. So by special request, Larry had asked me to play this song. We usually go out with a song and. One of Larry's favorite songs. Larry, you want to kind of explain a little bit why you like this
one so much? Al says he knows what he's going to play. Let's see.
Yeah. Yep.
I know.
Everybody knows. It's like religion to Larry. So okay. Go ahead, Larry.
No, you're doing wrong. You're doing well. Go ahead.
All right. Going to start it off. It's a great song. And the words are amazing. So pay attention to the words. We'll all fade out, and thank you all for coming. This has been marvelous. Really, really appreciate your time.
There must be light.
Oh, thank you for inviting us.
Burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue. If I can dream of a better land where all my brothers walk hand in hand, tell me why. Oh, why can't my dream come true? Oh, why? There must be peace and understanding sometime. Strong winds of promise that will blow away the doubt and fear. If I can dream of a warmer sun where hope keeps shining on everyone, tell me why, oh why, oh why won't that sun appear? We're lost in a cloud with too much rain. Trapped in a world that's troubled with pain, but as long as a man has the strength to dream, he can redeem his soul and fly. Deep in my heart, there's a trembling question. Still I am sure that the answer's gonna come somehow.